So as promised, I will try to demystify and talk with you a little bit about how to think about clinical trials. This is not going to be a laundry list of clinical trials. It's really about the nuts and bolts. What should I be pointing at? The screen? Okay, all right. Okay, so we're going to talk about clinical trial basics, some recent advances, some key ongoing net trials, and then how you can learn a little bit more about trials. So why are clinical trials important? So they are a key research tool for advancing medical knowledge and patient care. We do clinical research in order to learn whether a new approach is safe and effective, and which treatments or strategies work best for certain illnesses or groups of people. And only about 5% of US adults actually participate in clinical trials. Actually, our pediatric cancer population is much better than the adult cancer population. So let's debunk a few myths. So clinical trials are not proven better than standard treatment. I'm very careful about saying that when I'm talking to patients about clinical trials. Clinical trials are not just for patients without other options. There might be trials that are actually appropriate for patients who've had resected disease or for patients earlier in the disease course. So I think it's just important to ask about what setting is that clinical trial appropriate for. You will not unknowingly get a sugar pill. So some people think that they don't want to go on a clinical trial because they don't want to be, quote, a guinea pig. Well, this is clearly explained for patients who consider clinical trials. Some clinical trials do have placebos, but you are informed about that and told about the chances you might get a placebo, and if that's not for you, that's okay. I should also mention that clinical trials that have placebos are only ethical and allowed to have a placebo if in that setting it's acceptable to do nothing. So placebos are only allowed at that point. If you decide to participate in a clinical trial, you can change your mind. So you're not forced to continue. It is really at the decision of you and your treating physician. If at some point it feels like it's right to come off, that's acceptable as well. And then you cannot directly compare results of one trial to another. We kind of do that a lot, especially up here on the podium, but I think it's often not okay because the patient populations may be different. So for example, it might be a lung net trial and a pancreatic net trial, and it's really hard to compare those. So what happens when you go off of a clinical trial? So patients go off for a variety of reasons, including progression, side effects, personal preference. Your doctor will discuss other treatment options, including standard treatments and other trials. The frequency of monitoring may be less off of a trial, and tumor measurements are not considered standard outside of a clinical trial. And we're going to talk about a few of these different things. So clinical trials could be sponsored by three different organizations. So a sponsor really is someone who funds the trial. So it could be investigator initiated. That is, a physician like myself might think of an idea for a clinical trial, but then I have to go pitch it to get funding. So I might get some funding from a pharmaceutical company. I might get some philanthropic funding. I might get funding from a grant. But it is the idea of that investigator. Industry initiated are trials that are thought up by a specific company, and then they go look for sites at hospitals or academic institutions. A cooperative group clinical trial is a federally funded, government-funded clinical trial. These are often larger clinical trials, sometimes randomized. That trial that was presented earlier of the temozolomide versus temozolomide and capecitabine in pancreatic NETs was a federally funded clinical trial. And I should say most academic institutions across the U.S. belong to a cooperative group. It's meant to make the academic centers cooperate. That's why they're called cooperative group trials. And it allows us, especially in rare cancers like NETs, to pool our resources and our patient populations to do larger studies, but for rare populations. So phases of clinical trials. I touched on this a little bit earlier. This often starts in the lab or preclinical work, which a treatment may work in mouse tumors. Phase 1 tests safety, with hopes of efficacy. These are often smaller studies, usually 15 to 25 patients. Often any tumor type is eligible and defines the side effects and the best dose. Phase two clinical trials are starting to look at preliminary efficacy, often in a specific disease population, and they're usually fairly small, 25 to 50 patients. And then a phase three trial is a larger trial, usually randomized, comparing one treatment to another or one treatment to a placebo. And it's essential to assess the survival differences. And then phase four usually happens after a drug is FDA approved, so after phase three, and then we're learning a little bit more about safety. So this is a life cycle of drug development, so every drug has to go through all of these phases in order to achieve FDA approval. The entire course takes about 10 years. That is painfully slow, both from our perspective, but certainly from where you're sitting. And so if a drug succeeds at one phase, it then moves to the next, so it does have to be sequential. And even if a drug is FDA approved, it does not guarantee benefit for everybody. So there are many types of trials. So phase one trials are often dose escalation because it's a safety test. We start with a small dose and then slowly increase. A single arm trial means that every patient gets exactly the same treatment. And a randomized trial means that there's usually one treatment compared to another treatment or one treatment compared to a placebo. And that randomized trial is the gold standard. So let's just define randomization. This is officially a randomization by the National Cancer Institute. So patients are divided by chance into separate groups, so you can't choose which arm you're on. And that's to compare different treatments or interventions. And using chance means that the groups will be similar and that the effects of the treatments they receive can be compared more fairly. So for example, if it's a trial of pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, we want to be sure that the age is balanced on both arms, that the perhaps the Ki-67 or the grade is balanced, the gender, things like that. So randomization generally helps ensure that balance. A blinding definition, so when for some clinical trials that are randomized, especially for placebo trials, the physician and the patient are blinded to what arm they're on. So maybe both arms are pills. I don't know and you don't know which you're on. And so that also helps ensure the integrity of the trial so that I'm not biased, for example, and maybe keep you on a treatment longer than maybe we should. So design and interpretation of trials. So there are really strict eligibility criteria. Think of it like a checklist that we have to use to also uphold the integrity of the trial. So which nets, what grade, what primary site, is it growing or not? And then we also have to define how do we measure the success of a trial? So that's response rate, how much does the tumor shrink? Progression-free survival, how long does it take for the tumor to grow? Overall survival, how long do patients live? And then safety, and those are the four main measures of success. So this was a study that was projected or presented earlier. This is a study that I led nationally. It was a cooperative group study. And we're gonna use this as an example to walk through learning how to interpret a clinical trial. So this was a study called ECOG 2211. ECOG is the name of the cooperative group. It was for patients with progressive grade 1 or 2 metastatic pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. They were randomized by chance, 1-to-1, to receive either the combination of capecitabine and temozolomide or temozolomide alone. They were stratified, meaning that the arms were balanced for patients who had had prior everolimus, sunitinib, or concurrent octreotide. And this progression-free survival curve you saw before, I'm not going to go over the details, but we're going to talk a little bit about how to read it and what it means. This is what most of your physicians will look at to really think about how to implement this into practice. And you may come across this, you'll see it at meetings like this. And so the vertical axis is called the y-axis, is the progression-free survival probability. It's the number of patients who have not progressed. That dashed line is the median, so at 50% progression-free. separation of the curves is good, so that yellow arm is the combination, and the white line represents the temozolomide by itself. The x-axis, or the horizontal axis, is time in months. And so then we define success. So the primary endpoint for this study was progression-free survival. So ideally, we would like to see that one of those treatments does better than the other, meaning that it has a longer progression-free survival or delays progression better than the other treatment. And so by looking at this, so the separation of the curves, if you look, take and look right at the dotted line here, the progression, the median progression-free survival is longer in the combination arm than it is, so here it's around 23 months compared to 14 months in the single agent arm. A hazard ratio refers to a hazard of progression, so we've reduced the hazard of progression. So the hazard of progression is 58%, and so we've reduced that by giving the combination. So if any of you have been on trials, we do very formal quantitative tumor measurements. We have to do that in order to define success of a study drug, so we have to be very precise about that. There's an acronym that we use called Response Evaluation Criteria in Solid Tumors. And the key features are that we can't measure every single tumor spot. We can pick 5 total and a maximum of 2 per organ. And then we measure the change of these spots over time. I think it's better to use a cartoon to describe that for you. So imagine this is the blue is a liver. I'm not as good as a drawer as our surgeons here, so pretend it's a liver. And the yellow spots are tumors, and so we measure the longest axis or the longest portion of that tumor spot. That's what we use in the measurements, and we tally up those long axes. So here is a little table. So spot 1 is 2.5 centimeters, spot 2 is 6.5 centimeters, so the sum is 9. And so then we just measure those over time and we compare the percent change. So in 3 months, we've seen some shrinkage. So these measurements decreased and it was 17% shrinkage. In 6 months, we've had additional shrinkage and it was 44% smaller compared to the initial. Does that make sense? So shrinkage a little bit over time. And so on this particular clinical trial, we found that the shrinkage rate, and we define a reasonable amount of tumor shrinkage as 30% or more shrinkage from baseline. And so about 30% in each of these groups, so 27.8% in the temozolomide arm, 33% in the combination arm, experienced a decent amount of tumor shrinkage. So these treatments actually shrink the tumor. That's pretty different than octreotide or everolimus or sunitinib, some of these other approved agents. So we think about using this now for patients that really need tumor shrinkage. Perhaps they're having pain from their tumors, or perhaps they're having hormone-related symptoms and we really need to shrink it. Adverse events is another thing that, or safety that we look at in clinical trials. And they're collected and recorded also in a very quantitative way. And the adverse event severity is assessed on a scale of 1 to 5. And then we have to determine whether we think it was related or not to the study drugs. And there is, these are called attributions: unrelated, unlikely, possible, probable, indefinite. And there are formal criteria as determined by the National Cancer Institute for this. There's a whole searchable, we actually have an app for that, so it's very helpful. This is just a list of ongoing clinical trials. I'm not going to go into all of the details, but I think one take home from this I want to say, and I think especially I love speaking at these patient conferences, this is a very hopeful time to have this disease, because I think that there has just been an explosion of research in the last decade. Many patients that I was taking care of 10 years ago benefited from ongoing research and FDA approvals in the last 7 years. And I would anticipate that we will have more advances in the field. So this is just a snapshot of some of the ongoing important clinical trials, but there are many. This is one that was brought up earlier, but this is one of the key big national cooperative group clinical trials that is going on right now. It's called the CABINET trial. It's being led by one of my colleagues, Dr. Jennifer Chan out of Dana-Farber, but it is broadly open for all of the cooperative groups throughout the United States. And this is a study that also, I think, is designed really well because it has very broad eligibility for almost all of the well-differentiated neuroendocrine tumors. It does have a placebo, so it has a 2 out of 3 chance of going on the cabozantinib arm and a 1 out of 3 chance of going on the placebo arm. So how can you learn about clinical trials? I put in the local institution website, but most of your institutions, whether it's here at UChicago or elsewhere, will have a clinical trials portal on their website. Clinicaltrials.gov is the national website. It's a little cumbersome to search, but I would say start with your treating physician and your local institution. So take-home points. So we've made many advances in the last 10 years in both treatments and in terms of imaging, all due to clinical trials and to patients who were willing to participate. So for those of you who have participated in clinical trials, we thank you. They're really critical to making progress in NET treatment. And PRRT, immunotherapy, and personalized therapies are likely to be incorporated in future NET trials. And I think it's very exciting. So thank you all very much.